Let's have a look at the structure of the eyeball and the surrounding structure so that we can prepare ourselves for the future. It's the main purpose of the medical school is to prepare the students for the future. Do not miss, please, that to understand any subject that you analyze the data, have a discussion with your peers and with your teachers, and share your information. Remember, in a medical school, there is no spoon feeding. Anatomy is a visual descriptive science. Therefore, we use pictures, and a picture is worth a thousand words. This is an image where one can see that around the eyelashes there is a collection of pus and blood. This is severe inflammation of the margin of the upper eyelid. You can see that the upper eyelid of this person has a swelling, a reddish one, because there are glands in the upper eyelids. Therefore, what do we need to know? This is an abscess arising from the hair follicles of the lower lid. Therefore, we need some science to understand this problem. You are going to face in the future some kind of this situation where insects get stuck in the sclera of the eye. Foreign bodies can get into the eye on the outside, and you have to reflect the upper eyelid so that you can take it out. So we need knowledge of the upper eyelid. This image is showing that there is a foreign body stuck on the cornea of this eye, and if we look at the margins of the cornea, we can see that there are invading blood vessels ready to invade the cornea. The cornea should have no blood vessels. All sorts of different accidents can happen to the eye. The visible white part of the eye should have nice and clean and few blood vessels. Here we can see that vessels are increasing in number, and this is a kind of inflammation to the mucous membrane covering the visible part of the eyeball called the conjunctiva. Looking at this eye, one can see that there are two areas where there is some kind of collection of blackish material under the conjunctiva. Now, the eye is full of melanocytes because it has to be dark on the inside to perceive the light and the images. Now, melanocytes, when they go crazy and develop cancer, produce melanomas. Now, melanoma is a bad tumor. This is a case of hemorrhage under the conjunctiva of the white part of the eye. This usually happens in people who have bleeding tendencies or they cough very violently. Sometimes, because a person has a bleeding tendency or trauma, blood collects in the anterior chamber of the eye. Not enough knowledge of the structure of the eye can lead to total destruction of the eyeball, and we are not that kind of people. Sometimes the conjunctiva covering the white part of the eyeball grows over the cornea of the eye, preventing part of the sight. This is called pterygion. A common problem, especially in old people, is losing the transparency of the lens. This is called opaque lens or cataract. Some patients may complain of blurred vision in the center of the visual field. This is what a normal person sees. Some people, when they have problem with the optic disc, they see as if they are seeing through a tunnel called tunnel vision. In some cases, the person feels as if there is a curtain coming and closing part of the visual field. This is a mind map of the eyeball or the globe of the eye that has the basic knowledge of the different parts of the eyeball. Do we need to know the different parts of the eyeball? The answer is yes, because we have seen several cases where different parts of the eye can be affected. To get enough knowledge to treat people, we must arrange our basic information as in mind maps, and we must read the book. The eyeball is really a receptor that fits the optic nerve. This is a drawing of the eyeball, and we can only see the anterior part of that eyeball. This is a coronal CT scan of the head, where you can see the shadow of the eyeball. It is a kind of perfect sphere. This is a sagittal CT scan of the orbit. The green triangle represents the pyramidal shaped orbit, and at the anterior part there is the eyeball. The front part of the eyeball is modified, not like the rest of the eyeball, and the optic nerve leaves the eyeball posteriorly. This is a diagram of the eyeball, and what is visible from the outside is only the most anterior part. This is a CT scan of the front part of the head, where in the center there is the nose, and on both sides there are the two orbits, and anything above through yellow line is going to be visible. Most part of the eyeball is inside the socket of the orbit. This is what we see of the eyeball from outside between the two eyelids. What are the structures that can be seen from the outside? Now, on the medial side, near the nose, there is an angle between upper eyelid and lower eyelid. This is called the medial canthus. While the lateral one, also between upper and lower eyelids, is the lateral canthus. On the medial canthus, there is a whitish elevation called caruncle, and just lateral to it, there is a whitish elevation, a fold of the conjunctiva called mica semilunaris. The colored part of the eye is the iris, a part of the second layer of the eyeball, and in the center of the iris there is a black hole. It is black because the inside of the eyeball is black, and the junction between the colored part of the eye and the whitish part is called a limbus. It is the junction of corneosclerosal area, and the conjunctiva covering the whitish part of the eyeball is called the bulbar conjunctiva. The inside of the eye is blackish in color and appears as a hole in the middle of the iris. But when somebody takes a photograph with a flashlight, the flashlight will go into the inside of the eyeball and reflects back, therefore it looks reddish. Looking at this eye, especially the junction between the colored part, the iris, and the white part, the sclera, there is a demarcated line called the limbus. This is an eye of an old person where we can see that the colored part, the iris, and the hole inside the middle is the pupil, but the corneosclerosal junction has developed a thicker line of junction. This is called arcus sinalis. Now, when most of the time the upper and lower eyelids are open, the cornea and the conjunctiva are exposed to being dry. Dryness is very bad for the eye because it leads to ulceration. So we have two types of lubricating systems. Here is the watery lubricating system, which is made of the lacrimal gland present on the upper left part of the orbit, with several ducts opening into the upper part of the upper eyelid, and the tears will cover the exposed part, and they are drained by a lacrimal system starting with upper and lower canalicular system with small openings, which lead to a lacrimal sac in the lacrimal bone, and the lacrimal sac is going to drain to the nose under cover of inferior concha. is a view of the medial campus of the eye, where the blue arrow indicating the caruncle and the yellow arrow is pointing at the punctum, which is the opening of the lacrimal canaliculus. That was the story of the watery lubricating system. Now we are going to look into the conjunctiva. This is the structures making the upper eyelid, which is a mucous membrane. The conjunctiva covers the inside of the eyelid, goes up, then reaches a point where it turns back on the sclera. This is called the fornix of the conjunctival sac. Then starts to cover the anterior part of the eyeball until it reaches the beginning of the cornea. The part of the conjunctiva covering the whitish part, the sclera of the eyeball, is called bulbar conjunctiva. The one covering the inside of the eyelid is called palpebral conjunctiva. This is the lower end of an eyelid, where this area is going to have the oily lubricating system of the visible part of the eye. Here we can see that these are glands which look like sebaceous glands, and they open into their own special duct that opens into the margin of the eyelid, and it secretes oily material. This is meibomian gland. There are other glands which are connected to hair follicles. These are opening into the shaft of the hair, and they are called glands of Zeiss. Then there is another set of glands. These look like sweaty glands, and they are the glands of Moll. Now let's do analysis of the layers of the eyeball, which are also called tunics, which is next. The eyeball is made of three layers. The sclera is the outer fibrous layer. The choroid is the middle layer, which is pigmented and vascular. And the inner is the neural layer. These are the three layers that make the eye. This is a diagram showing that the three layers are very different in nature. The outer is the sclera, fibrous layer. The middle layer is vascular and pigmented, and the inner layer is nervous. Now, the outer layer is sclera, made of fibrous and elastic tissue. As it comes anteriorly, it stops as fibrous whitish sheath of the eye and changes to a different structure, which is very transparent and plays an important part in the receiving life and focusing it. This is cornea. Posterior part of the eyeball, covered of course by the sclera, and this is a point of entry of blood vessels, nerves, and optic nerve, and exits of veins. This is off the equator of the eye towards the medial side, and there is a slight distance between these two, and this is the optic nerve, and these are arteries, veins, and nerves, and this is called lamina cribrosa. It's an area which is perforated for the sake of exit and entry of vessels and nerves. This is a simple basic knowledge of the outer fibrous sclera. Can go through it and see the different, very basic knowledge of the different parts of the sclera. Now at the bottom, the cornea is the most sensitive part in the body. Let's look at the middle layer, the choroidal layer or the uveal tract. It is between the sclera and the inner neuronal retina and has lots of blood vessels and pigmented cells. As it comes anteriorly, it is going to change its structure. In this area, the anterior part of the choroid, it will have a ciliary body, triangular in cross-section containing muscles affecting the tension of the lens. This is the ciliary body. And then it has the iris, the colored part of the eyeball we see from outside. This is an animated diagram of the very basic knowledge of the choroid layer or pigmented and the vascular layer. You can go through it at your ease. Now the inner layer of the tree is the retina. Now the retina has lined the inside of the eyeball and it comes anteriorly. Before it reaches far, it is going to stop. The neuronal layer is going to stop, but the second layer of the retina is pigmented, and pigmented is going to continue. So the end of the neuronal layer is in a zigzag fashion. Now the retina, in line with entrance of straight light rays, has a depressed area which is most sensitive to light. This is called the macula. And then the neuronal layer, the retina, is connected to the brain through the optic nerve. And this is the point of entry of the optic nerve. This is an animated diagram of the neuronal layer of the retina, and please press the down button to see the different sequence of events. This is an animated diagram of the basics of the retina. Please press the down button to follow the different stages. We have already looked into the different parts of the three layers of the eyeball. Now we will address the cavities inside the eyeball. We will make reference to the lens. This is the lens and the cavity anterior to the lens is called the anterior cavity, and the cavity posterior the lens is the posterior one. The anterior cavity is divided into two chambers. Now, the cavity between the iris and the lens, or chamber rather, starts at the ciliary body, and then it is posterior to the iris and it is filled with aqueous humor produced by the ciliary processes of the ciliary body, and through the pupil posterior chamber is connected to the anterior chamber through the pupil, and the aqueous humor is going to fill the anterior chamber of the anterior cavity. The anterior chamber is on the inside of the cornea and anterior to the iris. This is a CT scan of right eye of a person, where you can see that this is the anterior cavity in front of the lens, and this is the posterior cavity, which is posterior to the lens. This is an animated basic knowledge of the contents of the eyeball. You can go through its different stages step by step by pushing the down button. Back to the basic diagram of the eyeball, and we will have a few words on the lens. The lens is between anterior cavity and posterior cavity. It has two different curves. The posterior curve is more than the anterior. The anterior is more straight, and this lens is attached to the ciliary body through the ciliary process. processes by a group of tiny thread-like ligaments, and the ciliary body has muscles, circular and radial. They affect the tension of the lens and change the focusing power of this lens. In this CT scan, you can see that this is the lens and posterior to the anterior cavity, and posteriorly we have the posterior cavity. Now, cornea. Cornea is a very valuable organ. It is a nice view of a perfectly good normal cornea. The cornea, as long as it does not have blood vessels, it has a circle of arteries which is surrounding the cornea, and they play a role in nourishing the cornea. Since a histological section at the area of corneospheral junction and the area of ciliary body. This is the cornea with its different layers, and this is the conjunctiva, that is the arrow pointing at corneal conjunctival junction, the limbus, and this is where the conjunctiva ends and the cornea begins. Now, conjunctiva has a subconjunctival space divided by loose connective tissue, is called subconjunctival space, and then blood collects in it, as in few images we have seen. Now the blood can fill this space and it stops at the limbus. Here is a real life image of what we have just talked about, the hemorrhage in the subconjunctival space stops at the limbus, corneoscleral junction. This is a histology of corneoscleral junction. Here we have the covering of the cornea, the epithelium of the cornea, and then to your right is the conjunctiva. You can recognize that it is the same type of epithelium. It is stratified, non-keratinized squamous epithelium. Sometimes the non-keratinized stratified squamous epithelium of the conjunctiva, for some reason, grows over the cornea and produces a case called pterygium. This is a histological section of cornea. On the outside, we have the epithelium we have just discussed. Then under the epithelium there is Bowman's membrane. Then comes the thickest part, which is stroma made of very nicely well arranged fibers. And then there is a basement membrane so that the endothelium will sit on. This is histology of the cornea, where we can see that the epithelium is sitting on this featureless basement membrane of the epithelium, which is called Bowman's membrane. Cornea is the most sensitive part of the body because it is very, very rich in nerve endings, and when you try to touch it, immediately the patient or any person will close the eye by orbicularis oculi supplied by the facial nerve. This is the corneal reflex arc. Touch the cornea and sensation through the ophthalmic division of the trigeminal nerve will reach the sensory nucleus of the trigeminal, and an interneuron is connecting to the facial motor nucleus, and the facial motor nucleus will send very quickly orders to the orbicularis oculi to contract and close the eye. This is a low power histological section of the different layers of the eyeball. This is the outer fibrous connective tissue layer, the sclera. The middle layer, the black one, it is full of melanocytes and blood vessels. It's the vascular layer, the choroidal layer, and the innermost layer is the neural layer, the retina, made of several layers of neurons. In the higher part of the three layers of the wall of the eyeball. Now, this layer is the outer sclera, the fibrous layer. You can see that due to processing, the fibers were separated, and the middle layer is the vascular layer, the choroidal layer, and you can see this is a large blood vessels and many melanocytes containing the dark melanin, and this is the innermost layer, the retina. This is a higher power of the three layers of the eyeball. The outer is the fibrous sclera, and here when we see inside of the sclera is the choroid layer full of blood vessels and melanocytes. Now, when we move the sclera, we will see the choroid. In this diagram, where the sclera has been removed, and you can see that the choroid is exposed, which is full of arteries and veins. It is very vascular. This is a diagram of the anterior part of the eyeball, and let's look at histology of the anterior part of the choroid layer. Here is the cornea, the anterior part of the sclera. That's the outer layer. The middle layer is modified in its anterior part, and in this way there is a triangular cross-section structure called the ciliary body. This ciliary body is going to give rise to ciliary processes, which are going to tiny ligaments. And then it also is going to give rise to the iris. This is a closer section showing the many ciliary processes coming out of the ciliary body. This is the iris in the front of the lens, and there is a longitudinal layer of muscle near the posterior layer. This is the radial muscle. This muscle, when it contracts, it produces dilatation of the pupil. Plus, there is circular muscle. When there is parasympathetic stimulation to the muscles of the iris, the circular muscles will respond, and there will be pupil constriction. When sympathetic and parasympathetic are balanced, the size of the pupil is normal, but when the sympathetic stimulation, it causes the radial muscle to contract and the pupil will be dilated. This is a diagram of the anterior part of the choroid layer, where you can see a cross section of the ciliary body containing the radial and circular muscle. This is the radial muscle and this is the circular muscle. This is a CT scan. Now, inside the eyeball, on both sides of the lens, you can see a shadow of a triangular structure. That's the ciliary body, and that's the one on the other side. This is a CT scan of the ciliary processes coming out of the ciliary body. They have 360 degrees tiny ligaments attaching to the lens to increase or decrease the tension on the lens. When you see such a patient, especially after severe trauma, maybe a car accident, we have to check first is the examine the pupillary reaction in both eyes. If both eyes are fixed and dilated and not responding to light, now this person is in great danger. This is a closer look at the three layers of the eyeball, and this is the choroid layer which we know by now, and then on the inside we have the retina. The retina is made of two layers, an outer pigmented layer with melanocytes and an inner layer made of several layers of receptors and neurons. This is a diagram of the very basic layers of the retina. The accident, the one facing the choroid is first segmented cell, then comes the photoreceptor fluorescent cones, then these fluorescent cones, when they convert light to nerve impulses, the impulses are picked up by bipolar neurons, and then they synapse with the ganglionic neuron, which will make the optic nerve. Now follow the story that this image is telling. The story starts here when the light gets into the eyeball, it's the retina, travels through the thickness of the retina, reaches the bottom of the retina, it's the pigmented layer, stimulates the rods and cones, the light is converted into nerve impulses. Now, the ganglionic cells will pick up these impulses and they collect from the parts of the retina, and then these ganglion axons will form the optic nerve. Here is the special situation. Now, thought starts here. The light hits the fovea, the depressed part, the most sensitive area of the retina. It affects the cone, and these cones will send their impulses into the ganglionic cells to form the optic nerve. This is a drawing of the rods and cones as they sit on the segmented layer of the retina. This is kind of a chromatoscope of the rods and cones. These blue ones are the rods, are taller, and the pink ones are the cones. Now this is a very important area of knowledge of looking inside the eye. This is the optic disc where the ganglionic axons collect and form the optic nerve. It should be yellowish, very well demarcated, and there is a lighter area in the middle and should be one third of the disc. It is also called the head of optic nerve. This is the optic cup, lighter area. Now lateral to it, there is an area which looks a bit darker. That is what is called the macula. And in the center of the macula, there's a depression. This is where the maximum vision is perceived where you can find only cones, and this is called fovea. Is the optic disc or head of the optic nerve, is the optic cup, and is the macula, and you can find in the center of the macula is the fovea. Here is the depression. The middle of the macula, the fovea. In this fundoscopy, that's looking at the fundus of the eye, where you can see the optic disc, but when you look at the fovea, it's very bad fovea. No clear macula, no clear dark fovea. In this fundoscopy, it's important to see that the optic disc has very sharp edges and the optic cup is shiny and regular. These are two examples of what one can see in fundoscopy viewing the optic disc. The one to the left has sharp edges, and the right area, the optic cup, is about normal ratio of one third of the optic disc. On the one on the right, it is quite obvious that the optic cup is too large. This is because an increase in the intraocular pressure pushes the optic cup to increase in size. In the retina, this is the only place where you can see the very small arteries and veins. If you look at the arrows, you can see that the arteries are stretching on the veins, and making a knitting effect. Therefore, always examine optic disc patients with hypertension. This is a view of fundoscopy of a normal optic nerve, optic disc, and a normal fovea. While on the right, the image is different. Now, these yellow areas all over the place are exudates coming from the blood vessels. This is what happens in diabetes. Therefore, always examine optic disc in patients with diabetes. Now, when the optic disc has blurred outlines, this is an indication that there is an increased intracranial pressure because the optic nerve brings with it the subarachnoid space filled with CSF. So this case is blurring of the margins of the optic disc. This is called papilledema. This is a view of the optic disc where the margins are very seen, because the CSF around the optic nerve and optic disc, and there is increased intracranial pressure, the result is optic disc edema. Always remember, always examine optic disc if you suspect increased intracranial pressure, because it's serious condition. This is angiogram of the retinal vessel, where you can see that blood vessel is coming from the middle of the optic nerve and branching in a nice way and reaching the macula, and there is hardly any blood vessel at the fovea. This is a normal figure. This is an angiogram of retinal blood vessels, where you can see that the area of the macula and fovea is devoid of blood vessels, and this is a case of thrombosis of retinal vessels. To the right, a normal angiogram of retinal arteries, but compare it to your left, where you can see there is an area which is missing blood vessels. This is a fluorescent study of the retinal blood vessels, where you can see that there are a group of exudates coming out of the blood vessels. This is the case of what happens in diabetes. This is a view of the eyeball, where you can see that here is the lens, which is anterior to the posterior cavity and posterior to the iris. This is an astrological section of the lens, where you can see that this is the capsule of the lens, attaches to the suspensory ligament, to the ciliary processes, and this is separated because of the preparation of the slide, and then we have the epithelium of the lens, and this is the stroma, fibrous tissue arranged in a very fine way. This is a higher power of the edge of the lens, where one can see that this is the cuboidal epithelium on the anterior surface of the lens, and these are lens fibers. This is a diagram of the lens, where you can see that the black circumference is the capsule. Underneath the capsule, anteriorly, you find the cuboidal epithelium, and the yellow circle in the middle is the nucleus, and around the nucleus is what is called the cortex. This is the posterior chamber of the anterior cavity, and this is the other one on the other side, and the fluid is produced in the posterior chamber by the ciliary processes, and the aqueous humor will go around and then through the pupil into the interior chamber. And this is the posterior structure to the lens, which is the posterior cavity. So the anterior cavity is a posterior chamber plus anterior chamber filled with aqueous humor. This is the story of production of aqueous humor and drainage. Production is going to happen by the superior processes of the superior body in the posterior chamber of the anterior cavity, and it is going to circulate into the anterior chamber and then it goes to the angle between the iris and the cornea at the place where sclera changes into the cornea, and this is the drainage area. Increase of aqueous humor due to increased production or increase drainage will increase the pressure, and the pressure will push the lens posteriorly, increasing the pressure on the vitreous body. When we look at this histological section of the anterior part of the eye, we will find that there is an angle between the iris and the cornea. The aqueous humor is produced by the ciliary processes of the ciliary body and is drained by a drainage canal of Schlemm present exactly at the tip of the angle between the cornea and the iris. This is the angle, and if there is any blockage in this angle, then there will be danger of increasing aqueous humor pressure pressing on the iris and the lens, and then on the vitreous body, and then on the optic disc. This is the posterior chamber, and these are the ciliary processes, and then this is the pupil, and this is the anterior chamber of the anterior cavity. This is the iris, and the aqueous humor is produced by ciliary processes. They circulate in the posterior chamber and then pass through the pupil and filling the anterior chamber, and this is the place of drainage. Here is the angle between the iris and the cornea, and this is the place of absorption of the aqueous humor, and it is made of trabecular meshwork. Sponge-like tissue drains the aqueous humor. If this angle is closed for any reason, then the drainage system of the aqueous humor is blocked, and the aqueous humor will accumulate, and the Now, because we know that the anterior cavity has anterior chamber and posterior chamber, this blood is collecting between the cornea and the iris. It is hemorrhage in the anterior chamber of the eye. Blocking of drainage of aqueous humor will create back pressure on the lens, and the lens is pushed towards the vitreous body, and the pressure will be distributed all the way on the retina and especially the optic disc. Now, on your left, it's a normal optic disc with a normal ratio of the optic cup, while on your right, because of the story we have just told in the previous slide, pressure on the optic cup will result into increase in its diameter, resulting into tunnel vision. This is a histological section of the optic disc, where you can see that the retina is going to end at this point at the edge of the optic disc, same on the other side, and this is the optic cup. This space is an extension of subarachnoid space where CSF is surrounding the optic nerve. This is a similar situation of the previous slide, where you can see that this is the retina at the edge of the optic disc, which is going to stop here, and to allow the axons of ganglionic neurons to collect and make the optic nerve. And this optic disc, as you can see, has no retina, and therefore it is a blind spot. Now, this is the beginning of the optic nerve as a bundle of axons of ganglionic neurons, and this is very important that we should know that the subarachnoid space comes from the brain and surrounds the optic nerve as far as the edge of the optic disc, and therefore a decrease of intracranial pressure is going to cause edema in this area. This is a section through the optic nerve from its beginning, and it is showing that this is the optic disc, and this is the optic nerve. This is the subarachnoid space coming from that of the brain and reaching the edge of the optic disc. Therefore, in cases of increased intracranial pressure, you see edema at the edge of the optic disc. These are four slides of transmission electron microscope of the optic nerve. Now, we can see that this is an axon of unmyelinated fibers, while this is a section of a myelinated fiber. That means this is mixed with myelinated and non-myelinated fibers. Here is a cranial view of the skull and the triangle represents the roof of the orbit, and when the roof of the orbit is dissected and taken out, and this is the midline, we can identify the eyeball in the anterior part of the orbit. This is the axis of the eye, and this is the optic nerve. The optic nerve comes off the axis of the eye at around 14 degrees and passes backwards to get out of the orbit through the optic foramen. This is a CT scan of the orbits, and it is quite obvious the shape of the circular eyeballs and the optic nerve extending from its posterior part towards the optic foramen. A sagittal view of the orbit taken by the CT scan, and we have seen this section previously where we can locate that this is the pyramidal orbit, this is the eyeball in its anterior part, coming out of the eyeball is the optic nerve. And as it goes through the orbit towards its orbital foramen to enter the middle of the middle cranial fossa. This is a frontal view of the orbit where you can see that here is the optic foramen or optic canal with other openings of the orbit. Openings of the orbit are very important because they can represent spread of infection and disease from the orbit into the intracranial structures. Therefore, you have to reactivate your